thrill to be here, and a particular thrill to be involved in my first poetry and science event, which feels very apt because it was here at Manchester University that I studied maths and physics 25 years ago, and I was very bad at it. But I've always had a real love for science, and I've always used it as inspiration in my short stories and now in my poetry. And perhaps because I have a background in it, even though I was very bad at it, I feel that I'm allowed to play with it. So I'm going to share some examples with you of what I like to do with science, most of them from my brand new chapbook, which really is still warm because it only came off the presses 8 days ago. So I'll read you some poems from that. It's called Nothing Here Is Wild, Everything Is Open, and it's got Newton on the front as well. So this first poem is called Pulled. Once, early on in my development, some boy took me to a roof to see Orion's belt, the Pleiades. I listened, looked politely where he pointed, but already then I knew, although he had left the door ajar and I was not yet fully formed, that this had nothing to do with stars, the tug of gravity. So, an interesting thing that seems to have come out for me of writing poetry is that it allows me to get a lot closer to autobiography, which I can't go near in my fiction at all. Obviously, in short stories, it's sort of buried, but it's buried quite deep. So that poem was quite autobiographical in that there was a boy and there was a roof and there were stars, but frankly, I wasn't quite so knowing at the time. As Jeffrey mentioned, I like to use science in different ways, and my first short story collection took inspiration from from articles in New Scientist, which is an amazingly rich source of inspiration for any writer. And this next poem is also inspired by an article from New Scientist. Honey. Bears, who when awake are not, become diabetic, it seems, as they hibernate. Scientists think this is what allows them to devour their stores of fat during those long winter sleeps. Do they dream of test tubes and reagents? Is there, on the tongue of every sleeping bear, the faintest hint, growing day by day, of sweetness? This next poem, also from New Scientist, but this was actually from the letters section of New Scientist, and this is pretty much exactly what this person wrote in to the letters section. And it's called The Biologist and the Birds. It is her bedroom window the birds fly into and fly into, trying to get through. It happens only in daylight, but she worries in the night after gently burying so many fallen bodies. It seems to stop after she moves her full-length mirror to another corner of the room. Perhaps it is the apparent patch of sky the birds were so frantic to beat their wings in. Science has no answers. Sometimes she sits on the edge of the bed for hours in the morning silence, waiting. You might have noticed that I'm not actually reading from the book, which is a very interesting thing for me. It's not actually something that I chose to do, this reciting, but it turns out that coming from prose, and I've been writing short stories for 18 years, I had trouble reading line breaks. It took me a long time to get used to the line break in my own writing, and I'm actually still thrown by reading them, even in my own poems. So it seems to be easier for me, although quite terrifying, to do it by heart. But this one I'm going to read you now is a prose poem. And it's called Hold the Baby. They said she had to hold the baby, so she held the baby, even though she had no notion why she held it, him or her. They said she couldn't look to see, so in her mind she thought of it as both a Jenny and a James, and she knew it wasn't right, but there was nothing more to say. They said they'd run some tests while she was holding it, experiments of a sort, but she was not clear what sort. Perhaps they measured angles, how she held it, how it sat there. Maybe they counted breaths, hers and its, all blood flow, all pressure, with machines she couldn't see. Maybe they wired up her brain and knew what she was thinking, feeling. Some time had passed, maybe minutes, and she wanted to drop the baby. Not hard, not on the floor, just to not hold it anymore. I never answer questions, by the way, about what my stuff is actually about, so we won't go there. The next poem is inspired by the year I spent as writer in residence in a biochemistry lab at Bristol University, which was a few years ago. So I did a science degree, and then I was a science journalist, and then I took inspiration from articles about science, but I didn't know what it was like to do science on a daily basis. So I went to hang out with some biochemists who mix stuff in test tubes and rock and stir and shake. And one of the most amazing things about modern molecular biology is that they can now tag living cells and see them under a microscope because they glow. So this is inspired by that. This too is prayer. No, not some lover's glance, a newborn's grin, sunset, autumn leaves, but this green fluorescent protein, a molecule borrowed from the jellyfish to turn our cells to glowing, dancing laborers we applaud as they go about their daily tasks, building inspection, maintenance. Now, they have us to witness their every act, not just, of course, benign construction. Not just, of course, repair, but how much better, though, to see, better to no longer be in darkness. Ooh, drops the book. Excuse me. So I'm veering off the chat book for a minute to share something with you, and I'm being a bit naughty because this possibly is flash fiction, although we'll call it flash fiction stroke prose poem. And this I was commissioned to write for The Verb on Radio 3 a few years ago in commemoration of the discovery of the Higgs boson. And it was the first time I'd gone back to physics because I felt like I couldn't take inspiration from physics because I was supposed to know something about physics. So I wrote this and then I worried that I would be lynched by all physicists. But it didn't happen, which is somewhat of a disappointment. It's called Totally Massless. Quark me, he hissed, sliding up in the dark. Go on, quark me. No way, I said. You're charmed, mate, if you think I'd... Bloody hell, he said. You're totally massless, you are, totally. And he held up his fingers right in front of my face. Gave me the boson, the sod. He always did like to mess with me, with my head. That was the last time. I've not seen him since. He made like a neutrino, just spun off, slipped away. I didn't worry at first. I had what to worry about, what to keep me busy with my particles and all that. Wasn't that enough? Didn't I have it snowed under? So I didn't miss him. But then, sudden, from one minute to the next, I felt him. Felt him undone, like he'd been anteed, like he'd been black-holed and no one cared, no one gave a flying fermion. Of course, I went to the authorities and told them. I tried to, anyway. They looked like they were listening. Looked like they were paying a Higgs bit of notice. They filed their whatevers under this and that. But I never saw a photon of evidence that they were searching for him. Really searching. I still hear him sometimes, on the edge of a dream. Quark me, he's saying, whispering it softly, almost romantic. Quark me, go on, just do it. And when I hear him, I wish I had. I really wish I had. I'm going to finish now with one more poem from the chapbook, and I guess this is my take on one of the bigger issues that affect science and affect all of us. And I must say that it was inspired by a story someone told at a conference that I went to about his father, and as writers do, I stole it. It's called And What We Know About Time. When it failed to alarm, my father took the clock apart, laid it all out on the kitchen table. While the dog dreamed and snored, we watched him clean every piece then, breaths held, attempt reassembly. It worked perfectly for the next 10 years, which was odd, given the 16 horological components my father couldn't fit back in. They lived out the rest of their lives in that kitchen drawer designated for such things. There must have been someone, somewhere, now, like my father, like the dog, the kitchen table, and that drawer, long gone, who once knew exactly what those 16 parts were for. Thank you.